all that kind of stuff. So
Dave was really kind of just a world-class customer service guy.
Okay.
And but he was also a great manager. He was developing into a great manager. And so when you go back to Palo Alto Bike Shop, he was like the guy that, you know, that really made the shop run right.
Gotcha.
And then he went to Wheelsmith. And in their heyday, really made Wheelsmith run. And then he in between those times, he'd come back to me for a couple of years and sort of burned out.
Yeah.
And, you know, he'd just take his job and run with him.
Gotcha.
I'm good.
So we were riding up the hills in your neck of the woods yesterday. So we need to do that more often. Yeah. Because it's so much. You go from, we're in North Beach. So you go from there, it's like 20 minutes to the city. And then you get everyone with their selfie sticks on the bridge. And then you're in the headlands, and it's like the same, you know, stuff that you do all the time. So you got to ride 6 hours if you want to get something interesting.
Yeah. You got it? Oh, yeah. Like, you, the open, and it's just like, you know, the people with the bikes around the bikes. And then you get, like, around the new tower. Yeah. So, like, you go there, it's flip-stop. Like, literally, like, you flip out, and everybody's just standing around, like, doesn't know what to do, like, where to go. And
you either at the pavilion at 8 o'clock for a century ride, or you pour your mountain bike in your car, and you ride the
Okay, how are you guys doing tonight? We're here to talk about Tom Ritchey. Okay, so I got asked to come up here. I've known Tom about 35 years. Got to get my numbers straight. Back when we were both young, and lots changed since we first met. 1980, I moved out from Ohio to work at Palo Alto Bike Shop, and
you know, back there, being into bikes. You know, I knew about Tom, never saw him in person, knew about his frames and things like that. And I don't know, the first week or so that I was, after I fell off the turnip truck and showed up in Palo Alto and started working there, Tom rolls in on his bike, and I think I stood there with my mouth wide open, just watching him walk in, lean his bike on the counter, go up the stairs and talk to the guys that owned the shop. And came back to reality when one of my mechanics said, close your mouth, the flies are starting to circle around a little bit. So I was pretty much starstruck when I first met him. But you know, over the next couple of years, we kind of developed a relationship, friendship, that type of thing. At the time, I was riding an old stump jumper and really wanted a Ritchey team comp. So I built a lot of wheels. So Tom, you know, talked me into building wheels for him at night. So I started building wheels to pay off this awesome red team comp, twin strut handlebars, you know, the cat's meow type of bicycle. And one thing led to another. In about 1984, I started working for Tom. And at the time we started out, it was Tom building frames, and he was up at his shop on Skyline, and I was at a warehouse, 1,200 square foot warehouse in Redwood City. And I answered the phones, I sent the frames to the painter, I prepped the frames when they came back, all that kind of stuff. And about 400 bikes a year we cranked out of there. You know, I built the wheels for him and things like that. And it was a real exciting time for the company. I think it was growing pretty fast, and you know, the demand was really, really high. And you know, one of the things that you know, thinking about what to say tonight, you know, we can go on Google, we can look at Wikipedia or whatever, and we can find out all kinds of bike things with Tom. But one of the things that struck me right away when I started working for Tom is the guy worked really hard. He deserves everything he has right now. And, you know, it's one of those things that he worked 12 or 14 hours a day, 7 days a week. And I can remember that I'd take the number four acetylene and a couple of oxygen tanks up to his house maybe once a week, once every 2 weeks, you know, driving a little Toyota pickup truck up through the mountains of the Santa Cruz Mountains with a couple of bombs in the back of my truck. But I'd show up at 9 o'clock at night, and all the kids were asleep. Actually, some of this was before his kids were even born, but everybody's asleep in the house, but Tom's out in the shop putting brazons on bikes, aligning forks, you know, doing all the stuff that didn't have the noisy tools so the neighbors didn't hear it. So, you know, back in that time, he rode his bike every day before cell phones and things like that. I knew that I could not get a hold of Tom between about 1 o'clock in the afternoon and about 4 o'clock, because he had this thing he called the Bermuda Triangle that he rode. And I don't know exactly what the roads are, but I know there was a lot of dirt and there was a lot of road bike going on back then. And the cool thing about that is that's where he thought up most of his ideas. I mean, it was a really kind of a peaceful time for him. He could think about product and stuff like that. And I can remember a number of times of getting a phone call at 8 or 9 o'clock at night. And I lived relatively close, 4 or 5 miles away. And he'd say, you gotta come over, you gotta see this grip I just thought about today and I just designed it. And, you know, really excited about it. So I jump in my car, drive across Skyline, go to his house, and, you know, walk up to the porch, the front door, and there's like a pile of wood or a bunch of soap on the porch. And what he did is he'd take either a bar of soap or a piece of wood with his knife, his pocket knife, and he'd whittle this thing out. I remember him handing me this piece of wood or a piece of soap that was the True Grip 2, which was the second grip I think that he ever came out with. And that's the way he kind of started with his ideas. And always looking to perfect things and not making them complicated, trying to make them very simple. And I think that throughout the years, you can see that in his kind of product line, very simple, refined, but right to the point. You know, as time went on with Tom, he continued to work hard, but he still had fun. He still rode his bike. He still stayed competitive and things like that when he rode. And, you know, part of the side of Tom that a lot of people don't see, because you see what's done in the magazines or in the media and things like that, but Tom, and my little relation to bike riding, trying to talk about Tom that you guys normally don't see, but in regards with bikes, in the Tour de France and the Giro, they have these climbs that are called ORS category, HC category. So I'm kind of a numbers and a letters guy, and I always try to take something like that and attach it to something. So the letters HC really remind me of Tom. And it doesn't have to do with, he's beyond category, in my words, with the products that he puts out and the bikes that he's built and the relationship that he and I have. But HC for me with Tom means he's crazy, okay? And I mean that in the most respectful way. And a couple of things that I'll throw out here is, I think it was 85, we were in his van again, gone to, I think, the first kamikaze downhill. And we're driving along, and I think I was driving at the time, and we go through Tuolumne Meadows, and we get to the top of Tioga, and Tom's like, just spur of the moment, stop, I'm going to ride down. And so I had his son Jay, who was maybe 2 years old, with me in a car seat, and Tom drags his bike out, and then another guy that was with it drug their bikes out. And I'm trying to follow Tom down Tioga Pass, you know, and I'm looking at the speedometer, Jay's screaming, you know, super loud, and I'm at 60 miles an hour, and I just see Tom disappearing in front of me. So I don't know if anybody's ridden in the Santa Cruz Mountains at all. There's a road called Kings Mountain Road. Not Tom, I'll get the numbers wrong on this, but a lot of the really good bike racers from the 70s and the 80s time themselves not going up, but down Kings Mountain Road, and they call it the six-minute club, okay? About 12 or 13 years ago, I got married. I was lucky enough to get married at Tom's house up on Skyline, and the next day we had this big ride, a bunch of people that had been in town. We had 30 or 40 people on it, and I was definitely not there at the end, but there were three or four of them left, and Tom was one of them, and Dave McLaughlin, Sterling McBride, I think Tom, maybe a couple other guys, tried the six-minute club going down Kings Mountain. I think Tom was probably the closest. I don't know if they got it or not, but you cannot ride on the correct side of the road on the hairpin corners and be at 6 minutes. So if anybody ever rides Kings Mountain, think about that, okay? The other part of my HC is, I don't know, 10 years ago or so, Tom got into airplanes, and he bought this airplane, and I think it was shipped over maybe from Europe or something like that. And they're at the Palo Alto Airport putting it together, and I happened to talk to him on the phone and said, hey, how's the plane going? It's almost together. Hey, I'll take you up next week in it, fly you around. And I'm going, do you do any of that, you know, studying or classes? No, I'll take you up in it. It's easy. I didn't call back for a couple of weeks. I was hoping he had forgotten about that. So, you know, hopefully you guys tonight will get to see a Tom that maybe you haven't seen before. To me, you know, he's kind of one of my mentors. He's taught me a lot. He's a guy that really works hard at his craft, constantly trying to perfect it and things like that. And one last thing, and I wanted to really throw something out that I could embarrass him, but I couldn't really think of that much stuff. But I've only heard Tom say a bad word one time, and I'm not going to repeat what it was, but he said a bad word one time, okay? And it's the way everything kind of falls into place with Tom. And we were coming back from a mountain bike race in China Camp, and we're on 101 right by Candlestick, Sunday afternoon, traffic is moving along at 65 miles an hour. We're in this old Peugeot 504 that he had. He's driving, we're driving along, the traffic kind of splits, and there's a car stopped in our lane like 20 feet in front of us. The hood's up, trunk's up, or something like that. And Tom yells out this word that I won't repeat, cranks the wheel like that, and I think we had an inch in the front, an inch in the back, and we made it into the lane next to it, and we missed the car. So other than that swear word that he said, he's absolutely perfect in my eyes, so we'll go from there. But, you know, one of the last things I'll kind of leave you with is that a thing that I've always admired about Tom is that I think he looks at the world through kind of a 10-year-old's eyes, okay? From the first day I met him to even sitting here talking to him tonight, he has a different way that he looks at stuff. And he has this enthusiasm and kind of this aura about him that you know that things are just cranking in your head. I was standing back here talking, and I saw him out on the sidewalk talking to somebody out there. And undoubtedly, his eyes are kind of scanning the room or scanning the sidewalk out there looking at bikes. I guarantee you, he is thinking about the next product that he's going to come out with. He constantly thinks about that. And I think it's one of those things that probably makes him great, makes him put out products like you guys see here and stuff like that. And, you know, it's one of those things that I wish I had his talent of being able to put 30 hours into the day and get the amount of work done that he gets done. But, you know, he's over there. See, he's looking at that bike right now, and he's thinking about something. Everybody look at Tom over there. He's staring at his P650B. So what do you think, Tom?
Needs
pedals. What are you thinking about? Why don't you come on up here. Tell me if I missed anything. Is it all true? Tom Ritchey. Yeah. There you go.
Thanks, Dave.
Yep.
I'm going to step in front of you.
Well, from one hardworking person to another, thank you, Dave. Dave was affectionately known by my family as my golden retriever friend. Because there is a faithfulness about Dave that you rarely, rarely find in other people. And Dave is a genuine, genuine friend. And he's seen all my kids basically grow up, and even came to the hospital and saw them in the delivery sense. So it's great to have friends like Dave. Thank you, Dave. One of the things that I'm looking at, and I'm looking at the age of people in this room, and I'm realizing a very basic element to this group, and that is you're all about my son's age, except for a few of you. The world of bicycles happened all before you, unfortunately. And the stories that really shaped the American scene and cycling happened pretty much before you. And the transition of a non-professional, completely devoid of any practical, in a practical way, component design, innovation, things that you all grew up with, didn't start until you guys were born. The American cycling scene, the American way of looking at a problem, started here. It started in the Bay Area, and really at a point in time when there were very few companies that you can name were in their infancy. In 1971, when I started seriously riding my bike, in 1972, when I built my first frame, there was really one professional bike shop in the Bay Area, and that was Cupertino Bike Shop. And they were an importer for Cinelli, Hetchins, Sanger, Campanello, of course, a handful of other European brands. But for the most part, the companies that you've identified or you can think of that are in the industry right now didn't exist. What happened? How did that change? And I'm sure you have all kinds of, you know, stories that you've kind of heard told and people tell, and the marketing departments of companies tell. But there were some very interesting sequences of history that happened around me when I was a young cyclist. And in the same way that Silicon Valley wasn't called Silicon Valley in that time period, people just had a confidence about them, and they thought something. You take frame building, for instance. There was no book. There was no lessons. There was no one that was gonna take you and give you an apprentice and work under their shoulders. There was no tooling. There was no jigs made. There was materials. There was no materials. So the way that you look at the craft now and how fast it's grown and how available product is and how competitive it is and how artistic it is, really was almost non-existent. I was one of half a dozen frame builders in 1972, 73 that was making a craft of it. And actually, by 73 and 4, I was actually making a decent living, and I chose, in my high school senior year, after disclosing to my father, actually my father came to me and said, son, you need to talk to the IRS. And I said, what do you mean, Dad? Well, you're making more money than me, and you need to disclose that. And so he didn't want to get in trouble. He didn't want me to get in trouble. And I realized that my choice had kind of come alive, and I was ending up in not going to college, not really pursuing what he had become, which was an engineer. But I had decided I was going to pursue the world of bicycles and the world of not just frame building, but component design. And that was in 1974.
Tom, that's great. This is Morgan from the background. I'll be throughout this whole thing asking some questions throughout. I think what comes to my mind as you're saying that is, you know, were you coming up with these, you know, frame building and, you know, componentry solutions and tire solutions because you felt like lived? Was it just your mind? Was it the way people were riding differently and there needed to be a different sort of engineering or what have you to, you know, to brought to the table? What was it that brought you to where you are now?
It's a long answer because it's kind of all of the above. If you can imagine back in 70, in the early 70s, there was no professional sport. There was no one that was paid money in the United States to race their bicycle. Therefore, if there wasn't the money to pay you to race your bicycle, there wasn't money to do much else other than maybe pay an entry fee, maybe help you with the maintenance on your bicycle, not giving you a bicycle, but the maintenance on your bicycle. And the idea that you were pretty much self-funding and self-creating your opportunities was the life of the racer. And so, as a young racer, and somebody that was trying to excel in that, and I did, it was all about affording the best. And affording the best meant, in the beginning, buying a used Cinelli B that was broken, and at age 14, learning to braze and repairing it, and then assembling the bike myself. So there was a cost, an entrance cost, there was a maintenance cost, there was a cost to upgrade, and a lot of that happened in a very short amount of time, and I ended up buying a Bridgeport mill when I was 17. I ended up buying a Morisaki 17x40 engine lathe when I was 18 that was a $10,000 piece of equipment. And these pieces of equipment at a young age allowed me to make not just tooling and the things that I needed for making my bike frame business, but also components. And the components I made in the beginning in 73, I made stems. Chromoly stems that were half the weight and stronger than the Cinelli 1A stem that was available back then. I made my own bottom brackets. Phil Wood was just a fledgling company in 71, 72, and he showed that it could be done. He showed that you could make a bottom bracket and a hub set, which is what he made in the very beginning. So the affordability of being able to you know, have a business and make product. You know, in the beginning, I wasn't interested in anything but going fast. So the competitive drive to win races and to have the lightest, strongest, stiffest, most powerful sprint and you know, was a drive. And so there was a lot of selfish-driven factors in from my racing side that ended up turning into a business opportunity for me.
You say that, but it sounds like there was a lot of almost what you see a lot of today, this adventure
long, multi-day sort of touring, cycling stuff happening at that time, or at least by you. Would you say a lot of that stuff kind of catered to or kind of shaped the types of products you were making? Did that kind of fit the riding style you had, or was it really race only?
Well, there was two different dimensions that my life was being constantly driven by. And the racing side, which was a growing national level of racing, particularly in Northern California. We had most of the Olympic team living in the Northern California area. Mike Neal, George Mount, Flip Waldteifel, Keith Moen, Jacques Boyer. I all raced with them, and they were all kind of in that Olympic level of the sport. But the other side of me was the guy that loved to ride a bike, and I ended up flirting with both extremes at the same time. An interesting story that, you know, Dave probably has heard about is there was this crazy guy, Yopes Brandt, that lived in Palo Alto. And Yopes was 6'5", and he sadly just passed away, but his influence on the racing community was something that was well known back then. Lawrence Malone, top cyclocross racers and riders back then, wrote an article about him, and the article was called "The Force Who Rides," and it was in Bicycling Magazine. And there was the guys that I trained with, some of the best riders in the country, living within 10 miles of each other, thinking about a 120-mile road race and whether they were going to race that on Sunday or they were going to go on a Yopes ride instead. And the question would be, well, I don't think I'm in shape. I think I'll race the road race. And people just could bear, I mean, you can't believe that story now. But amongst the Category 1 racers, we were more concerned about being left out in the wilderness and not getting back than being in the protected field of a 120-mile road race. So that split my personality down the middle, and I ended up choosing to retire in 1976 and pursue just love of cycling and love of long rides.
So you speak of Yopes, and it sounds like he had a massive effect on your life. He was friends with your father, it sounds like, and brought you out on some of your earlier rides. But it sounds like there's some other kind of talents that he had past engineering and that kind of thing with you as a brand. From what I've heard, he was the designer of the TR logo on the head tube and the Ritchey logo on the down tube that has really stayed almost unchanged to this day, which is pretty magical for a brand that's been around for so long.
Yeah.
And I just wanted to see if there was anything else, you know, graphically that he's had an effect on in your life or...
Well, my dad was an engineer, and he was a very much of a Renaissance engineer in a lot of ways. My dad helped me make my first bicycle frame. My dad was a cyclist. My dad introduced me to Yopes. But Yopes was on a level of engineering he was a mechanical engineer. He worked for Porsche. He helped Porsche design the first 911 disc brakes. He was a cyclist that thought about every little thing that had to do with a bicycle and bicycle design. He was a larger guy. He was 6'5". He broke product. And because he was an endurance rider and his riding was always on the edge and at the limit of product and breaking it, he was constantly working through why. And as an engineer, he had very strong opinions. And as a German, he even had more strong opinions. And so Yopes, I just remember basically, you know, the humbling process of meeting Yopes at age 15 and being basically told that that who am I after 100 years of the talent, the pool of talent that was responsible for the modern bicycle. Who is I? Who is this audacious 15-year-old kid to come along, build his own bike, and think it was going to work? Not to mention build other things, you know, and which I did. And so within a period of time, in a unique set of kind of circumstances, the bike that he was riding broke. And guess who he turned to repair his bike? And after about 3 or 4 years of repairing every tube practically in the bike, he finally turned to me with enough confidence. He said, "Okay, Ritchey, build me my bike." And at that point in time, he designed the decals. He designed the logo. And so that's the story of the logo. That's the story kind of in a nutshell of Yopes and just what a strong influence he was to me, but others. He was a grounding influence. He was always challenging everything that we did. And it wasn't just me. It was Peter Johnson and a number of other local guys that he had an influence over that went on his rides. And the assumption was, well, the constant, you know, voice in the back of my head was, you know, who am I to come up with something new that has been around for so long? And that was a very good thing for a young man to have in his life, because I was needing it. I got through somewhat of an engineering degree in 3 or 4 years with Yopes that I would have never had.
So along that same thread, there is an undeniable kind of look and feel from the early years of Ritchey to now. Everyone can see here with the P21 on the right and the P650B on the left here, not just paint. I mean, there's lines and some other structural things that kind of have those connected. So Brian Verner, who's worked with you slightly and filmed some pieces with you, had a question that he wanted to ask, and here it is. As a tinkerer, you've always been trying to progress, but there's an attachment. There's an undeniable attachment to classic.
To
he
what?
Wants to know about the...
To what?
To classic. Hmm. And he wants to know about that balance of principles, and if one gets in the way of the other ever... If you're ever blowing past one sort of thing you do forever for whatever particular reason,
you know, I think, you know, you look at nature. Nature is the art form of something that is beautiful and is designed, you know, beyond our abilities. And the flowing lines of you know, birds in flight or whatever you think of, you know, it's always a beautiful, it's always beautiful. And a fillet brazed bike is always going to be beautiful, you know. It's a forged part is always going to be beautiful, just because you can't contort a piece of aluminum or steel differently. If you design it right, it's always going to have a flowing nature to it. It needs that. And the lines of a weld and a buttressed area that, you know, has sharp transitions just is always been ugly to me. It's always been less than the optimum way to make it, following the look of nature, following the look of my eye. And that's just always where I've gone. I've always wanted to make something pleasing to look at. And I've found that pleasing to look at means that it's designed right.
So I'm hogging the mic. If you guys want to put your hand up and let me know if you have any questions. Oh, we have a question from the audience.
Well, it's actually a comment. Do I speak into this? What you just said right there reminds me of the guys from Apple Computer. You know, to make an analogy, and they're from Cupertino and all that stuff. But you're like philosophically, that's kind of similar. You know, what you just said. So.
Thank you.
Give up the mic.
You could drop the mic if you wanted to.
One of the things that I wanted to share is that the quote I'm about to read is kind of something I keep around and I think about. It says, every day I remind myself that my inner and outer life are based on labors of other men, living and dead, and that I must exert myself in order to give in the same measure that I have received and I'm still receiving. That was Einstein. And it along the lines of Yopes, it was his philosophy. It's just like not taking 100 years of how we got to where we are for granted, and also not putting any higher importance upon what we do than what we do, and letting the market and letting the results that you think are there actually come to the surface or not. And it's very important for me as somebody that is trying to make a contribution. And that was another thing that Yob said. It's very, very difficult to make a contribution. And to make a contribution, it's like people, there's millions of patents that are completely unused. They're not contributions. They're patents, they're ideas. People get, spend a lot of money, taking them to that through that process. But do they ever get turned into a product that's actually functional and usable? No. Innovating. What?
Do you have any patents?
Yes, I have patents. But the breakaway is a patent. And there's other patents, but for the most part, they're few and far between. And being focused on actually innovating in a way that you build on someone else's work is really my story. Because as Einstein said, you don't really have to say anything more than that, he built on other people's work.
Talk about your story and some of the problems and stuff. I would like to hear about some of your greatest failures, both product side, maybe business side. You and I discussed some of these things before, obviously the last time we talked, but I think that's an interesting thing for a lot of people, because you see a company that can be successful, but it doesn't happen without just tremendous errors. And I would like to hear about tremendous errors. Those are all very interesting.
Yeah. There's, I understand your point. I understand where you're going and the importance of it. And I'm not denying that there's all kinds of errors. But the tremendous error is something that doesn't need to happen.
Sure.
Okay. Because if you have the right people around you, if you're you have the right humility in terms of someone like Yopes who's gonna throttle you if you don't do the right thing, they keep you from a lot of errors. And there's a lot of benefit to just having the right people around you. So I've always been a big proponent of community, and I've always been somewhat of a I'm a pain avoider. I can it's it's obvious to me when I look around that pain is happening, and I'm a Geiger counter for pain. I know what that does and what that can do, and it's not that it doesn't happen. Some of the most personal pain is very much, you know, part of my history and part of my story. But I've been spared tremendous amount of failure because of people in my life, because of a lot of wonderful people in my life. That being said, I use myself as a guinea pig, okay? When I raced, when I made stems, when I made bottom brackets, when I made my own components, when I made my own seat posts and other things, I broke them, and it cost me a race. But that was at a young age. It was at an age where those things were not affecting other people, not affecting anyone but myself. And that was one of the things that Yob schooled me in, is that, Ritchey, don't sell that shit. Excuse me, Dave. You know? And Yopes would swear. He taught me how to swear, actually. So, and that's what he'd say. He'd just say, you know, until you... Okay, another thing, we did not have testing machines. They went to the moon with testing machines, but basically, the world of cycling didn't have the benefit of modern testing machines. We were the testing machines. Having a race team was a testing machine. You know, you selling something to the customer that he broke was a real bummer. and that was something that was drilled into me very young. And because I was a good testing machine, because I was winning races and I was using the product at a point where I could break it, and I didn't want to break it, I didn't want to hurt myself, I didn't want to have an accident, a lot of things that I would say could have happened in a public sense didn't happen. And if you're talking about product, if you're talking about business mistakes, you know, there's a lot of story in that. And I survived myself multiple times when it came to business mistakes, because I never went to school for any kind of business kind of experience. It was all seat of the pants. It was just one very simple adage that my dad said to me when I was 13 years old, and when I started doing things on my own, he said, never go into debt, son. Never go into debt. The borrower is the slave of the lender. And I practiced that. And so when it came to partnerships and other things, I'm the 100% owner of my company now. I'm probably unique in that way. This is just a fact. There is no older brand, owner brand left in the United States, older than Ritchey. I don't know how it happened. I survived myself. I survived my mistakes. That's how it happened. And I'm thankful that I'm small enough that I can keep things to the size that I can kind of divert and change and morph and grow when it's good and shrink when it's not and adjust that and stay within never borrowing more than I can, you know. It's all just kind of, you know, one decision after another, living and learning. And I'd love to help other people, you know, in that way too. Yeah.
So that said, you know, we're talking about failures and both business and otherwise, you know, there's a question that was out there about ideas that you might not have taken in retrospect. Is there anything that you had an idea that you wanted to act on and capitalize on that you never did, or something that you saw later and you're like, oh, that would have been great for the Ritchey brand, or anything that's been out there in the world that you're like, oh, I thought of that when I was 15 years old. Why didn't I do it?
You know, I I mean, Dave gave me a lot of credit beyond the amount of time and hours that I put into work. And so people, I do have a reputation of working a lot and working hard, but balance in my life was always very important too. So I was married young, I had three kids. I rode my bike not 3 hours a day, I rode it an hour and a half. When my kids came home, I was there for them. I got up at 5 o'clock in the morning and I started working before they got up, saw them off to school. They went to school, came back, saw them. I'm getting around to answering the question. But the main thing is that you can only do so much if you want a simple life, if you want a life that has quality, has balance, has freedom. And yes, I've had ideas on how the derailleur should be designed and how, you know, all kinds of shifting and other things that you don't see with the Ritchey brand on it. They existed. They actually had an existence at one point in time that I didn't bring to market. But the choice was focus on, actually, my design philosophy in 1983 when I left Fisher and Kelly. My design philosophy was concentrate on everything that Shimano doesn't make. Because I had worked with Shimano up until that time, and they had achieved tremendous quality in their product. And I shared their design philosophy, shared their engineers, a lot of relationship with their engineers, and I realized that the whole world was an oyster if I just focused on everything but Shimano. And that was how I attacked the components that I developed. Tires, rims, stems, handlebars, seat posts, pedals. You know, you go down the list. And that was the basis of the team, Team Ritchey, and the dominance of Team Ritchey in the 90s was the components that I brought to the team that they wouldn't have had a choice in if they were on a Shimano or a Suntour team. I brought that to them. They had to use a triple chain ring if they were on a Shimano or a Suntour team. They could use a double with me. And there was other things that had to do with other teams and their influence on them. And so, you know, long story short, it was the relationship with racing, the team, the results. I had the biggest, smallest team in the entire industry. 90% funded by me. Other teams, big budgets, big companies, big rider salaries. Little Team Ritchey, kicked butt, funded by me. And guess what? It felt like I was racing when I was out there, and if they failed, I failed. And I came back to the drawing board, and I had to fix it. Otherwise, it was going to cost me more money that I didn't have.
We're stepping now into the mid-80s and late 80s, early 90s, and we could stay there for now. There's some other stuff I want to go back to, but for now, since we're talking about the race teams, I mean, you had Thomas on the team pretty early on. You had Ruthie. You've always had
Henrik.
You've had a powerhouse of racers,
yeah.
That held on tight for a long time.
Yeah.
Was that... I mean, you're talking about just a second ago that was 90% coming from, you know, from you. I mean, there's a lot of sacrifices coming there. Were you actually using that stuff for R&D, or was it really to get the name out, or was it just the true love of racing that you've always had since, you know, a young kid?
Racing, you know, always to me was how you defined product from the very beginning. It was the test. It was a test in competition. And again, right now, product is hidden behind the backdrop of a team. You really don't see it. You really don't see when a guy only uses a set of wheels for one race and boom, they're gone. You know, you don't see a lot of the things that get switched out that in just not too distant past was used all season long, had to work, was a training bike, was a racing bike at the same time. Budgets didn't ask for 120 bikes for a team of 32. There was all kinds of reality checks that were going on in the 90s, not that far ago, not that long ago. So really, it was, I'm kind of diverting, but the personal use of the product, the validating of the product on the race, and how it supported my design philosophy was everything but Shimano. helped in creating a complete aftermarket program for me and OEM program for me as a company, and then others followed. They learned that was a good success format, and everything, you know, kind of changed in the bike industry, but the racing really was the way in which the product became real to people, and they felt confident to buy it. Because again, it's hard to, I mean, the culture right now in 2015, you go and put something on your bike and you have this happy slappy expectation that's going to be great. Back then, there was a very real weight to being the new kid on the block that's going to the world with my name, with my brand, and saying, here I am. I just developed this stem. I just developed this seat post. I just developed this crankset. That didn't happen. That was a new thing. You were going up against Campy. You were going up against Shimano, who had developed it. They had raced it. They had proven it. And if I didn't prove it in the racing world, if I didn't prove it in a real sense, I wasn't going to succeed.
So we're talking about mountain bike racing right now. Your early days were road cycling. That kind of transitioned into the love of the dirt and off-road.
Yeah.
And you spoke to it just a second ago, but I think it'd be good to come back to it, and then we can go back into the 80s, the mid-80s, is the mountain bikes partnership. And your time with Fisher and Charlie, and you know, there's several versions of what has transpired there and the situation there. And I'd love to see if there's anything you'd like to say about, you know, anything you want to clarify about that time back then with Fisher and Charlie and you know what where the separation came, why it came, and why you wanted to kind of go off and do your own thing, and where the origins for that, you know, for that came from.
Most people have a very kind of superficial understanding of the brand of Ritchey as a brand in that period. They don't realize that when I built my first mountain bike, I'd already built 1,000 road bikes, road, touring. You know, I was already a valid, very successful frame builder in the United States, and they think, you know, for some strange reason that, you know, Ritchey started when the mountain bike started, and it didn't. I was a frame builder, a component designer, and I had a reputation, and Charlie worked for a moving company in San Anselmo. Gary was working at a bike shop, I believe as a mechanic at the time. I knew them just because I was involved in enough, you know, NorCal community and some racing at that time. And the idea of building a mountain bike just was not a big deal to me, or building a bike that was along the lines of what was to me an interesting way of building a bike, or you know, a new way of building a bike. And it was uniquely suited to me at the time and place, because I had abandoned lugs. And if, you know, I built hundreds of lug bikes, but there was a point in time in about 74, 75 where I went completely away from lugs. I was primarily building lugless. But the rest of the industry was still building lugs. And I had just kind of developed this niche of building a lugless bike, which meant I had other tools, I had other skills. I could change the diameter. I could use non-standard shapes. I could change the shape of the tube. I could ovalize a tube. I could basically randomly play with practically anything about the frame that I could think of, I could conceive of. TIG welding hadn't started. There was no TIG welding. It was a very small amount of TIG welding. It was primarily in the BMX world, but not in the road bike world. There was not one single TIG welded road bike in 1979 that I know about. There might be. Okay? Maybe, you know, even into 80, 81. It's hard to believe. TIG welding was a completely non-accepted way of building a bike, building a road bike. Fillet brazing was becoming accepted. It was with that I came to the problem or the idea, or you know, how to build a mountain bike, or how to build at that time what was called a clunker or a cruiser. And I had the skills, I had the ideas, I had the component experience, I had the stem handlebar seat post already being developed on a road bike, and so I had the fork making experience. I could make my own fork crowns. I made my own fork crowns. All the original bikes were fabricated two-plate fork crowns. I had already done fabricated two-plate fork crowns on road bikes for years. So all the challenges that were out there to any other frame builder or someone that was going to take on the problem didn't exist with me, and people knew that. And so the first bike that after I said to Joe came down, ordered a tandem for him and Otis to do a transcontinental ride or race on. He showed me his first mountain bike, and I said, "That's cool. I've got to build something like that. I've already built this 650B bike. I'm going to build that next." And there's a 650B whole history to Ritchey that has never been told. So he goes back and he says to Gary, "Hey, Richie's going to build a mountain bike." Next day I get a call. "Hey, if you build one for me." It was because he knew I'd do it. He knew I'd do it not just soon, but I knew I'd do it well, and I knew I'd do it right, and I knew I'd do it light and race worthy. And when he came up to pick up the frame a couple months later, I just said, "Hey, you know, I built a third one, and one for me, you know, this one. And if you want to help me sell it, you know, let me know." And I realized that Gary and Charlie were really good at sales in the community of Marin. And so there was, you know, kind of scratching my head. Okay, you know, I've got a thriving frame company, bike business company, and I said, "Okay, if you guys can sell bikes, I'll work with you." And that was, the informal and kind of nuts and bolts of the relationship. It turns out they weren't businessmen. They didn't really, you know, have the ability to hold on to some of the things that they wanted to. And I had a family that was growing, and a company that was already established. And I found myself in a couple of years pretty much just not able to work with some of the things that were going on. And I had to say goodbye. You know, there's a lot more to that story, but basically I was the R&D and the manufacturing, and they were the sales and marketing. When I said goodbye, I had to find out my own way on the sales and marketing side. And Mike Neal, who I used to race with, was available, and I called up Mike and I said, "Hey, you want to start, taking the bikes around and selling them nationwide?" And he said, "Sure." And he came to work for me for a year. Then Dave Prion came to work for me, and then Mike went on and he started take on the responsibilities of Motorola and the whole team in Europe, which was a great thing for him, and it changed his life and all. But that 1 year period of time, Mike was my guy on the road, and he picked up the pieces that I needed picked up, and Ritchey kind of launched at that point in time. But really, Fisher, I should say Ritchey as a independent launch, but Fisher and Kelly weren't a brand until that point. So there's no, and the idea that Fisher was a brand since whatever is not true. It's Fisher became a brand when I left, and that was 83. That was the end of 83 into 84. And so the story's kind of, I've never really talked a whole lot about it, but it's kind of an inverted story in that sense. They both great guys, they both wonderful storytellers, great at selling, great at marketing. There's more to be said some other time.
That's great, thanks for that. So we're still talking about frames here, and we can transition into, I think, components, in a little bit. But I think the last question that I have about frames would be Ritchey Logic, and the idea of how it was different, how it was providing something that was anything different than what people were offering. You talked about budding, external, internal budding, styles, and how were you doing something that was needed for the time?
Okay, well, going back to my comment about the world of lugs, the whole world up until, believe it or not, 1979 was based on lugs. And it was a 1-inch top tube, an 1⅛-inch down tube, a 1-inch steering column, believe it or not, these crazy diameters and dimensions that we all think about, and just like it's ancient history. Well, that was the world. For 100 years, you buy a set of tubes, 11 pieces, you buy a set of lugs, and there you go. You're a frame builder now. Okay, well, mountain biking and mountain bikes and the whole way in which I was gifted and skilled and training myself and developing my own way taught me that these tubes are designed wrong. These tubes are designed with budding that's makes them heavier than they need to be, and diameters that aren't optimized. And if you went to a frame company and you went into their production line and you saw how they build those lugged bikes, and you saw how hot everything got in order to make a lug work, you realize why the tubing was designed the way it was. The tubing needed to absorb an area of heat that was this big. In fillet brazing or TIG welding, all you needed to have is an area this small to do the work that you needed to do to join it. And I thought to myself, wow, I've got all this extra thick tubing because everything's being blowtorched to death, and I can save the weight, I can optimize the tubing, and I can play with a couple of tricks that I was thinking about in the back of my head. And in the same way that I came to kind of upset the apple cart in the component design, I pursued upsetting the apple cart in the tubing design world. And my ideas were very revolutionary. They were not only condensed budding, but they were differential budding. Okay? That means the front end of the tube at the head tube needs to be stronger than the back end of the tube. I mean, it makes perfect sense now. It's all the impact is in the front. But for 100 years, it was the same. There was no difference. So now I thought, okay, now not only can I condense the budding, but I can also make the gauge different in the front and back. And I challenged the tubing company, can you do that? And they said, yeah, we can do that. And so I went to Columbus and I gave them a couple other tricks. I gave them not only that, but I gave them force directional budding, which meant not only is it thicker in the front of the bike and thinner in the back of the bike, but there is a top and bottom orientation. It's a completely organic thing like they do in carbon fiber. And I challenged them with that, and they couldn't do it. They tried and they tried and they tried and they couldn't do it. And so I tried for about a year with Columbus, and then I went to Japan. I went to Tange, and Tange did it. Tange figured out how to do it, and they developed their own prestige heat treating processes right at that time. And I ended up in a bike that very much looks like that one over there, ended up in 89, putting it under Don Myra in the inaugural Mammoth World Championships in Mammoth, California, and he won. And this was at a time when the world was being taken over by big aluminum tube bikes, hardtails. A couple of suspension fork guys were out there. But the world was on this fast track to replace everything steel with aluminum. Okay? And I was on this other track to reverse it. And I did. I reversed the onslaught of big aluminum, you know, tube bikes from basically slogging it out in the market and everyone getting the same looking Cannondale bike. And it was a boon for me. I mean, I ended up, you know, having frame builders, you know, that were my peers want the tubing. And I ended up, you know, selling it to Bridgestone and other companies. And they ended up, you know, competing head to head with my guys on the racing side of thing in the 90s. And they ended up painting over Ritchey bikes, you know, their team colors and buying frames. And anyway, it was a very, I mean, people don't know the story of Logic Tubing, but it turned into, you know, one of those subtle backstories of Ritchey and this, and how the frame building world changed. And it was because, first of all, I had abandoned lugs and I had changed diameters. And mountain bikes basically went my direction. And then road bikes went my direction. And then construction went my direction. And then the tubing went my direction. Pretty much everyone. Columbus finally figured it out a couple years later, and they gave me the great compliment of naming their product Genius. But giving me no credit.
So we're hearing about frame construction. We're hearing what was available at the time and where the direction of riding and racing was going towards. But I've heard that you've been somewhat standoffish of the suspension fork very early on. And I'd like to hear about that, and maybe if that's still alive to this day within you, or if you've kind of let go of that sort of hold out.
Well, I had real riders, first of all. I mean, Thomas, Ruthie, Henrik. My riders were cross riders, they were road riders, they were real good bike handlers, athletes. And they wanted first and foremost something that worked, something that wasn't going to disappoint, something that wasn't going to result in a DNF. That was my job was to get them to the finish line. And I saw the new products that were out there. I saw them and I tried them and I looked at them and there were DNFs. There was, you know, guys that didn't finish and their bikes would go behind, you know, this stage, and, you know, the RockShox guys were, you know, for me, it was the real world of racing. It was showing me something that I would say wasn't there. I mean, the average guy was loving it. He was going, man, John Tomac, he's riding this fork, and it's John Tomac, you know? And there was business that was, you know, dollars were happening, and all kinds of things were going on. But I was in the racing side of things, and I was seeing the real world. And so for years, about 96, 97, Thomas, who's a very good friend of mine, total Swiss, completely, completely wonderful guy, said, "Dom, I want a fork now." And so we ended up working with RockShox, but I was basically holding out, looking for the product to get better. And until they were going to race, they won world championships on that stem, you know, 4 or 5 years in a row. So they knew how to ride bikes. Number one, they knew how to ride bikes, and I came from knowing that you could do a lot with just skill.
I want to take the time to see if there's any questions from the crowd. Go with you in the front. If you could just speak up, sure. You'll get a chance in the blue hat.
Hello, Tom. You talked a bit about how a lot of the companies that were around when you first started out, we don't really hear about anymore. You also talked about not building anything that Shimano makes. And I'm curious, so, I mean, I view the mountain bike and your contributions to that to be quite revolutionary in the industry, not only in terms of technology, but also in terms of the industry structure. A lot of companies, like Shimano in particular, became dominant out of that era where components were very critical, and they had the right components for mountain bikes and then added road and so on. So I'm curious to hear more about that story, and what do you think is the next great revolution in bikes, technologically?
Well, okay. Shimano was a unique company in the sense that, in a very similar way to Ritchey, because Shimano hardly ever did anything first. Okay? In the same way that I just told the story about the suspension fork, blah, 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 I was a student of okay, you know, let's make sure it works first. Let's make sure the design makes sense. And then let's do it right. Okay? You know, I hope we're all done with the idea of who invented the mountain bike. You know, it's not about who invented the mountain bike. It's who did it right. Who put the pieces together, thought of the problems, figured it out, and did it right. Okay? In the same way, Shimano, it's like they took their time, they weren't the first to do something. And some things that are unique to them in their skill, they never did. Or they never did with any kind of serious effort. It's like the headset. They never worked very hard for that business. They just let it go. They just let it alone, you know? And they could have easily dominated that. But they worked on problems that they knew they could make a contribution in and that they could do well. And that's what they did. They focused. They focused on drivetrains and chains and gearing and hubs and bearing systems and they did that right. And other companies come along and they focus on those same things, and they've got an uphill battle. They've got a challenge. I have a unique relationship with Shimano because we had almost, you know, okay, you know, just this weird Japanese respect for one another that they wanted me to use BioPace in the very beginning. And I would not use BioPace. This is before I developed a crank. And it was really because these Shimano cranks, they're the only cranks that Shimano ever made. If that's a Shimano, my eyesight isn't really good. Yeah. Okay, they're the only cranks that Shimano ever made for mountain bikes that are round chain rings. They made them round just for me. Everyone had to race BioPace. They held me off. I said, you guys, I'm going to develop my own crank if you make me use BioPace. And so it really, and then it got to be, okay, you want me to use three chain rings? I'm going to do my own crank if you want me to use three chain rings. And I finally just said, I'm done with respecting that, you guys. You guys are great, but I'm making my own crank. And so that's a story behind the 2x9, is everyone else was plagued with front derailleur problems, dropping chains, blah, blah, blah. And I came out with the 2x9, and my riders were successful on that. But anyway, I'm not sure if that's the question.
Well, that was a good bit of history. The second part was, what do you think is the next, like, transformational technology in the bike industry? What do you think happens?
I really can't answer that question. And if you knew kind of my story and you knew the honest Tom Ritchey that's standing in front of you, you know that really I live from day to day. I live from moment to moment. I live from ride to ride. And I don't see a whole lot beyond that. And I think so many things have happened, and in the framework of a contribution, which is my whole framework, I don't see a whole lot. Okay? In the framework of what the marketing guys in the industry are going to do, I know they've got everything cooked up for you guys. They want you to keep buying bike after bike after bike. And which is great. It keeps, you know, keeps the industry alive and all too, but it keeps my company in somewhat alive. But for the most part, the bike that we're riding right now, even the bike we were riding 10 years ago was a wonderful bike, an amazing bike. And the bikes that we will ride in the future, you know, they're really going to be, to me, recycled ideas, recycled components of bikes that have already existed, which you're seeing. And we're going to rediscover things. I mean, your age, what surprises me is when I talk to people that are in their 30s or 20s, and I say, do you remember this? Do you remember this? Do you remember this? They don't remember it. So they don't even have a reference point of what was being developed when I was their age, or when I was 15, or when I was 16. They don't even know that, you know, I'm sure that triple cranks will come around, you know, in 10 years, and they'll, wow, there's triple cranks. You know? Anyway, that's just a little bit of my strong personality coming out in that comment, sorry.
That's why you're here, thank you. Yeah. We actually, in the gray hat, if you have a question, and then we can move on.
You actually already kind of answered my question, but I guess maybe on a more personal level,
yeah.
To switch it up, I guess, so I can compare, and on a beautiful Saturday morning, or at least it was in Oakland, what would your perfect Saturday be, and, like, given the book, like, Tom Ritchey, you know, like, what time would you wake up? So what your choice of breakfast would be, to God forbid you ride a bike, like what bike would you ride, to maybe what time you'd go to bed. Beautiful Saturday morning, of course.
A beautiful Saturday morning. Well, actually, every day is a beautiful Saturday morning in Tom Ritchey's life. Because I wake up next to beautiful Martha. And I end up going to bed next to beautiful Martha. So, and my day is filled with beautiful Martha. And beautiful Martha making me breakfast. And going on a tandem ride with me. So really, for the last, one of the jokes was, I don't know what it's like to work for somebody. I've never worked for anybody. So I know that sounds kind of crazy, but you know, I don't think I ever filled out a W-2 or W-4. Someone did it for me. Somehow, I'm not avoiding any tax. I'm actually very good at that, very committed to that. But the idea of waking up and kind of, you know, doing what I want to do in a day and going on a ride when I want to go and designing and working and all that just kind of flows out of somewhat of a just starting the process at a very young age and being able to continue on to now. And I am just incredibly thankful and blessed that I'm able to do it with somebody that's as amazing as Martha.
That's great, thank you. Any other questions from the crowd? Yeah. You in the white with the vest, go ahead.
Yeah, of course. Two-part question. You were a very accomplished road rider when you were very young. My question would be, why, and Shimano kind of answers this question, but why didn't you go more into the road and jump so heavily in the mountain? And secondly, how did you not sell out? There were lots of other very prominent guys who did.
Well, there's... I'll answer the last one. The temptation is there, and the mistakes, and the ideas that you can have a better life, and all those kind of things is there, and it's a lot of times what we don't know about is that either a company can't afford to keep going. There's just poorly run business practices. There's businesses that, you know, that just lose their market share or whatever. So, you know, not having to be, a very wise person told me in the bike industry, he said, Tom, there's a lot of companies that are out of business out there. They just don't know it yet.
Who is that?
A guy named John Lilly. But which basically was very important for me to hear, because sometimes you don't have the choice. The choice that happens, you know, is. I mean, we live in a passion-driven industry. We live in an industry that everyone, at you know, not everyone, but twice as many people want to be in it that are in it. And want to do, you know, want to be a frame builder, want to have a component line, want to have something to do with the industry, and it's just a matter of that volume of people and the attrition and the ultimate, putting out good effort, you know, for a period of time and ending up realizing you don't have anything to show for it. And there's wonderful craftsmen out there that just, you know, barely hang on. So that was the last. What was the first?
Why so heavily in the mountain and not road?
Well, the fact is that anyone who looks at my company, I've pretty much been. Even though I sponsored a dynasty level team in the 90s, I also sponsored the U.S. national team on the road. You know, Bobby Julich, Chan McCray, even Armstrong for one year as a junior transitioning into the national team. I mean, there was Ritchey in the Peloton, and there's been Ritchey in the Peloton all through the years in the Tour de France. You know, it hasn't been at the frame level, but it's been at the component level. And so people who know me personally know that my roots are you know, as committed to road as anything. I would say that that another, you know, there's a unique story on the mountain bike side that I really, really love, and that is the relationships, the way that the mountain bike side of the sport has kept it fun, and has kept in a great sense the purity of just the one-on-one competitive way in which it's raced, and you are your own mechanic, you're your own you know, solution to a problem, you're your own coach, you're your own everything. I mean, there is still that basic founding principle of me when I was racing on the road that's still there in mountain bike racing that is not in road. No one can say that about road anymore. I mean, they're just about, you know, wheelchaired to their bikes and put on them and and, you know, please, you know, don't say anything bad at the end if anything goes wrong. And, you know, it's just, there's just this coddledness to the roadside that just is so far away. I mean, the $10,000 time trial wheels and all these kind of things that constitute being on a road team, it's just unreal. It's big business, but it's not who I am. I mean, the return of the road bike, the gravel bike, and these other bikes that, you know, to me were just bikes, is a good thing, you know.
That's great. Thanks, Tom. Anybody have another question here?
I was just curious. For so many years, when I think of a Ritchey bike, I think of a quality steel bike. And there's clearly a movement to carbon. And I'm wondering your take on that as a material, and if you keep the steel as real mantra to your bikes, or what your take on that?
Well, most people know that that my steel road bike has a carbon fork on it, and and there are some very wonderful, unique characteristics of carbon. If you don't drill holes through it, and you don't do certain things to it, so there's still limitations to how well carbon works. But the you know, the material, the right material for the right job. I mean, a chain is still steel. A cassette is still steel. A pedal axle is still steel. There's steel in the most carbonized bikes that are out there because it's the right material. Okay? There's new steels that are always being developed and playing with, and there's a new steel coming out of Korea that people are hopeful about that's the weight of titanium and one-tenth the cost factor, and it's steel. It's a steel origin material. Steel is what nails are made out of. It's what barbed wire fences are made of. It's train tracks. It's the industry. It's the basic material. It's the most honest material. Steel is a material that's got a personality. Steel is the only material that you can have its inner density soft and its outer core case hardened and hard and tough. There's no other material like it. The things that you can do in the alloying of it and the joining and the forming and the refabricating and the changing of it, there's nothing like it. The only thing that's better than steel is wood. Really? I mean, when you come down to building blocks and what you do with something and how you can craft something. I work with wood every day of my life. I work with steel every day of my life. There's nothing going to replace it. And there is there's wonderful carbon that's out there, but I tell you, there's nothing. Carbon has to be so well engineered and managed in the building process and the manufacturing process that it eliminates a human error that isn't in steel and isn't. It just makes it expensive. It makes it expensive to repair. It's a wonderful material on certain things. I love my handlebars. My handlebars have a wonderful shape because they're carbon. And because we're testing the heck out of it and we're constantly worried about any material flaws, we're on that, you know. But if I could make a handlebar out of steel, I would make it out of steel in that shape because it'd be a wonderful bar. Yeah, I mean, steel is a material that comes back to its elements. It's basically an ashes to ashes material. It reduces itself into the earth again, just like a piece of wood. It's, you know, there's nothing like it, and that's why I'm committed to steel.
That's great. Thank you. Any other questions from the crowd here? You here?
So when you go out on rides, do you find yourself still jumping on some of the older bikes like the P21? Or do you find yourself riding some of the more modern bikes like the P29 or anything? And if you ride the modern bikes, do you still feel like they have the same feeling that you get from the older bikes that you built?
You know, the honest answer is I do both. I've got full rigid modern bikes that are steel, and I've also got the full suspension bikes that are the state of the art. And one of the things that's important to me as a component designer is that I know what the market is looking for. I know what the market is working needs. I know that the components that I design have to be compatible with it and have to work with it. So if clearances change, if certain things change that I'm subtly aware of, I don't want to be caught off guard. But you know, along the lines of just kind of taking that question and kind of morphing it, because a mountain bike can be locked out now, it's turned into a both. It's a unique bike. And carbon, because it gives you the weight advantages, gives you the ability to put all the suspension and the things that you need for a mountain bike. So you've got this lockout, fully rigid, and you've got this fully functioning suspension bike at a cost. It's definitely an expensive bike. That's an indisputable evolution in the technology that is at this point in time very, very appropriate to be, there's a value to that. I cannot take and discredit that at all. Learning how to ride a full rigid bike is good for you. It's going to improve your skill if you ever jump on a suspension bike. If you ever stack yourself up and go over the bars and get yourself out of control, you're going to know it. You're going to ride it more thoughtfully if you train yourself on a full rigid bike. Just like it is for me riding a regular steel road bike or a road bike off road, it's going to teach me things that I need. I got to be sharp on. There's nothing. I'm not going to get that if I insulate that bike in a bunch of suspension. So there's values to both. Full suspension brings people that can't ride a bike into the sport, keeps them, makes them happy. you know? And then when they get to maybe thinking that, you know, either they're, you know, they're ready, they can, you know, they usually go off and experiment with something else. It's also something, you know, that isn't going away. I mean, it's just not. You know, I got to be realistic about that. And so, anyway, back to, I have a stable of bikes. I ride them all. And there's two reasons. One is that there's a lot of good product out there that's both. And the other is I need to know what I'm designing.
We're going to pull it back in just here for a quick second. I think something that we're actually, I don't think we have a single breakaway frame here, but I think it'd be good to know about the origins of breakaway and how that came about. And how it just, you know, how it's formed, basically your type of riding style, whether you're a traveler or what have you.
Well, if you could go back in time and kind of look at, you know, my origins of road riding, basically the way that Yopes rode, and being minimalistic and being your own self-contained person when you traveled. And having to take care of all your stuff and be, you know, kind of, you know, not dependent upon anyone else. And the way that he rode and I gravitated toward and enjoyed, whether it be solo riding or riding with others, we'd get off a plane, and what do you do with a box? What do you do with your gear? What do you do? I mean, so the breakaway in 1998 was my solution to that. And I wanted to get off a plane in Zurich, and I wanted to, at that time there was lockers. I wanted to take my soft shell case and all the things that I traveled with, stuff them in a locker and go off and my airport and leave Zurich International Airport on my bike and go ride my bike for a week or two and come back to it and do everything, you know, that I pull out from my locker and go back on the plane. That was the original design criteria of it. Then I became a pilot and I wanted to take my bike in a small plane and some other things happened. But the original idea had to do with just, you know, having a bike that traveled, but that still was a bike with no compromise. It still was a bike that you would ride, you would race, you would, you know, not feel any difference with it than your favorite bike. And that's the history of it. Yeah.
I'd like to ask another question that we have here about the past and present state of American frame building and what you feel, the good, the bad, you know, how you feel like the climate is out there. And if you appreciate what everyone's doing and that's that sort of.
It's a fantastic thing to watch and go to the Handbuilt Bike Show year after year. One of the problems with bikes right now is the customization of a bike is gone. Until you go to a frame builder, you will never get a bike that fits you right. The reason for that is because all the bikes you're being, you know, wined and dined to buy and the carbon bikes, they come out of a mold. And the cost of that mold, that molding is so expensive that they really have to choose a small, medium, large, extra large kind of, you know, design. And the growth of Ritchey has happened largely because the rise of those because the popularity of carbon bikes has made it that I'm the guy that fits, I'm the custom frame builder for the guys that buy the carbon bikes. I'm the guy that makes the custom seat posts that have 0, 20, 30 millimeters of offset. I'm the guy that makes the crazy 140 millimeter stems. You know, this is a sad reality. The way that you know, the frame builders of the world can come to you and says, "Wow, yeah, I can make you a 58 by 59 top tube, and you can, you know, have your what? I mean, you can still, get a bike that's got the right stem and the right seat position. But if you look at the pros that are in the Pelotons, I mean, it is just mind-blowing to me. They're spending, a company is spending $1 million on a guy's contract and giving him a bike that doesn't fit him. I just, you could go to Craig Kalfi, you go to a custom carbon maker and you could morph that, you could change something and that guy could get a custom carbon bike, but he's not. I'm still solving those problems. So, you know, the good side of frame building is that you're still, you know, they're not bikes that are gonna be in the racing circuit, but they're bikes that the average person can get the benefit from.
I want to ask you some questions about current day, and then we can bring it back to the crowd here.
Current day.
Your operation within Ritchey. So, as far as day-to-day operations, are you fully involved? And then on top of that, are you involved with all things design? Are you the design leader for all things Ritchey at this point? Or do you have somebody that works alongside of you that you're able to kind of bring up? And
well, people who know me know that I learned to delegate years ago. There was a point in time I couldn't do shipping and sales, and Dave Prion came to work for me. And there was a time when I needed a CFO, and my CFO came. And there's a time when I needed a global marketing director, and Sean came to me. There is a growth to the company that's basically been there behind the scenes, the people that are really the day-to-day, and I'm just, at this point, I'm doing the design. I'm the guy that's kind of wears pretty much the, from the crash test dummy hat all the way to, you know, the initial design concept and carrying the process through. And I learned that years ago. Dave McLaughlin, who I don't mention enough, came to work for me as a racer, and he was the one that worked with me on the formation of Team Ritchey in the modern development of a dynasty team, you know, and learned marketing in the process. So there was a lot of people, a lot of amazing people that have worked for me through the years. And I finally, after 42 years, I gave over the CEO position January 1, 2. So I entrusted that to a long-time employee that started out basically in the mailroom, and now he's the CEO of Ritchey in Lugano, Switzerland.
That's great. So we spoke already about the current state of, frame building in America. And I want to see what you thought about NorCal Racing League and that whole scene and how it's taking off and your kind of involvement in that, if at all. The person who asked this question is David Smith, who's a photographer tonight. And actually, specifically, he wanted to ask about the half of a cow that you bought.
Huh.
And what you plan on doing with it?
Yeah, the genetic half cow.
Yeah. we can hear about that half cow, but we can also hear about what your thoughts are on, the burgeoning, cycling scene in Northern California.
Yeah, well, I, just was tremendously inspired by Matt in his vision for coming from a teaching job, a math job in Berkeley High to starting the NorCal League and the vision that he had. I mean, I grew up when I had to petition the school to get any kind of relief from the PE program back in the 70s so that I could ride my bike rather than go to gym class or PE class. And now it's just a normal thing that schools are getting their own league started all over the country. So I support them when I can. I try to support them as much as I can. And they're they're doing what I tried to do years ago, and they're succeeding.
I want to open up the floor for a few more questions. So if anybody wants to raise their hand, I'd like to keep it somewhat quick, and then we can kind of bring it back in-house.
You spoke earlier about Shimano and how you wanted to develop things that Shimano wasn't. Did you develop any drivetrain or derailleurs or anything that you felt that they weren't doing quite as well as they could have done?
Yes and no, but you know, if you've been in this industry for 40 years, you've thought about it, your own way of doing something, and so going down a path, maybe in the same way that Shimano maybe went down, unknown to other people, you know, a path, whether it be a headset or something, has gone on in my company, and I've spent, you know, lots of money and tooling and other things, only to say, after it was finally done, you know, I didn't get the mark. I didn't hit the mark, you know, and so rather than introduce a product that really, you know, was not the solution to a problem that I thought was going to be there, or the market changed, or other things happened, is a backstory to Ritchey, and is a backstory to probably a lot of companies. That I was tempted, that I thought about it, that I wanted to change it, that I had a new chain idea, that I had a new free will idea, that I had a new way of making, you know, the shifters. Yes, and I've done them, prototyped them, and not brought them to market. Not necessarily. The main things that I would find would be, you know, in races. Racing was when stuff happened, and you'd learn from those mistakes quick. As I said, it was an expensive thing to find any problem. So not solving a problem was unacceptable to me, and I was uniquely gifted in solving the problems pretty quickly. And whether it be product development quickly or solving a problem quickly, I was very hands-on. I was the mechanic for the team. You know, not only the guy that made the bike and a lot of things, but I pumped the tires up and, you know, adjusted the derailleur and got the guys, you know, the equipment. I mean, we had a mechanic too, but I was right there pretty much, you know. So there was that, and there was also things that were happening. I mean, to break a product in the Bay Area on a mountain bike is not easy. I mean, it's hard. But if you go to Moab, if you start traveling to Moab back in the 90s when people were starting to ride slick rock and all the trails out there, you could see all kinds of stuff in a very short order. And I would go on a pilgrimage every year to Moab and I'd learn a ton of stuff. So there are certain areas, I know that there's areas that, you know, really chew stuff up and break things, and that's good learning territory. Yeah.
Where should I ride a mountain bike before I die?
Where what?
Where should I ride a mountain bike before I die?
Rwanda. Yeah. It's absolutely one of it's called the Switzerland of Africa. It is as beautiful as it is on a mountain bike and trails. It is in the interactions with the people.
So Tom, if you could actually speak to that real quickly. That was something that is on our list here as to your time there and how much time you spent there and why and what kind of brought what was your draw to that community and why.
Well, I hit, the wheels came off my bike, so to speak, in the about 14 years ago, and my wife left me, and she didn't really give me a whole lot of reasons. I was just, you know, kind of figuring stuff out, wanted to reconcile with her in every way I could possibly do, and I needed ideas, and I had a wonderful friend that said, you got to go to Rwanda and ride your bike. It was just like the farthest thing from my to-do list or my bucket list, but it was the best thing I ever did. And, you know, not only did I start thinking about life differently and my situation differently, you know, it's like, you know, the second day in, you're interacting with people that, I mean, are not only survivors visibly in their bodies by machetes that had cut through their arms and neck and head and things, and you're smiling and shaking their hand and high-fiving them, but you're seeing them on wooden bicycles. And the wooden bike is just, it's just beyond belief. I mean, I've got a calendar, a couple of calendars back there. You're welcome to look at it. But I mean, the idea, the coming from every year with a pressure to design something innovative, new, valuable to the marketplace, and going to a place where Rwanda, where they've been forgotten off the face of the earth, and they invented their own technology. They invented their own way of bicycle by using a machete and making wooden wheels and nailing on cut up car tires and creating a suspension for a steering, you know, column that I mean, it's like wonderful. I mean, it was like mind blowing to me that people were that inventive, that they were developing their own technology, all based on the bicycle and what they could afford, and thousands of them were out there. Thousands of people were making them, and they were useful. They weren't, I mean, this wasn't a toy. This was a functional evolution of the wheelbarrow. I mean, they had hundreds of pounds of potatoes and coffee beans and things strapped on these bikes, and they were going sometimes almost as fast as us downhill. You know, without hardly anything, you know, using for brakes. So the story of Project Rwanda was kind of an outflow of going over there and having my world kind of in a sad place for years and years, and realizing that, you know, when I got back on the plane and decided to come home, it's just that, you know, what I do with my problems really is going to define me, you know. And I needed to make some changes in the way I looked at my salary life, and so that was the beginning of Project Rwanda. And started a national team and invited my friend Jacques Boyer to come over and help with that, and started a coffee bike program to help the coffee farmers, and ended up promoting tourism, and tourism is just it's like the fear of going over there, just forget about it. You're going to be in one of the best countries in all of Africa to not have fear issues, and be in some of the most beautiful dirt roads and trails that you've ever ridden on.
On that same thread slightly, is there anything non-cycling inspiring that's in your life right now?
Wood? Yeah.
In what form? Any form?
Pretty much any form. Yeah. Yeah. I'm kind of a, you know, Steve Potts and I both are closet woodchucks.
Yeah, Steve did a lot of the early saddle designs in wood, correct?
Yeah, well, I don't know about that. I don't know about, you know, but we go off into the woods and we cut down trees and we mill them up. I mean, that's what I'm talking about. We're lumberjacks, And we love it. I mean, it's just like a, you know, it's been one of those things that I built all the house. I live in a log house that I built 35 years ago. And I built three other houses, and I've used my own materials. And so sawmills and the whole wood shop thing, it's kind of an alter ego of mine. So that's inspiring.
What about music or art or anything like that?
Well, I definitely have my taste in music that are along the lines of classical and jazz and guitar and stuff. But, you know, I'm not really, you know, driven by that. My other passions were and still are to some degree aircraft. And I've made basically three planes and done all the learned fiberglass, learned composites, learned the whole.
And you have passengers that actually are willing to ride with you. That's you're at that
point. Yeah. And but anyway, there's other things. Sailboats have always been, you know, a big you know, anything with wind, anything that has to deal with wind. The wind is the ultimate equalizer, and it. I mean, I'm my own wind tunnel. I mean, I know. I'm a scientist of wind. If you're a really seasoned rider, you know wind. You know when. You know everything about it. You know the valley that you're going into, the direction to do a loop. You know how the wind is going to affect where you are, and what side of the road even you're on. And all kinds of things, and it's so sailing, cycling, airplanes, everything to do with wind and wood.
The earth.
Yeah. One of the things that I wanted to also just take you guys into a kind of a perspective that I have that doesn't, I don't really share that often, has to do with the culture that I touched on in the 70s leading up to the mountain bikes. And really it was the culture in the United States, you know, there was no professional cycling pre Le Mans. Le Mans, you know, Boyer and Neil and these other guys, they went to Europe. They didn't come back and create pro cycling in the United States. They went to Europe and they stayed there. It wasn't until Le Mans that he brought it back. Did we then have a vibrant professional culture in the United States? And that all happened about what time? About 1980. And when Le Mans went over and he came back the superstar he was, he did it differently. He dictated the terms. He turned the tables on the components he was going to use. Up until then, everyone just went and, hey, you want me to ride Campy? I ride Campy. You want me to ride this bike? I ride this bike. You know, Le Mans went over there and he came back with a contract. I'm only riding this stuff. I'm only riding these frames. I'm only riding this helmet. I'm only riding, you know, these parts. He turned the tables on the whole world of pro cycling. And then he went on to win and continued to win. And people think that the mountain bike kind of had its origins in and of itself. You know, that it just kind of sprung up because some guys went downhill and they got, you know, connected with some, you know, motorcycle heads, and those motorcycle heads got, you know, excited about it, and they then invented the mountain bike or whatever. That's not the way it happened. And really, the story is, from my perspective, I was living it, I was in the middle of it, I was connected to LeMond. I was connected to, you know, the infancy of the sport. The whole world's attention was on the United States because of LeMond. It's like we couldn't do anything right up until that point in time. We didn't have the respect of the component makers, the frame builders, the designers at all. We were like the bastard cyclists of the world over here until Le Mans. And if you could imagine a bunch of guys that were making mountain bikes thinking that they were going to change the world of cycling, forget it. I mean, they were guys that wore their pants backwards. I mean, they didn't even know which way to put their shorts on. I mean, seriously. I mean, there was nothing serious about them. I had friends tell me, Ritchey, don't waste your time making those bikes. You're going to ruin your business. It really wasn't, there was, no, I mean, it's like, hey, for 2 years after the Wright brothers flew their plane, they hardly got any press. I mean, it's like our thinking, our thoughts about just, you know, what's innovative and when it started and how the story is told, it's just wrong a lot of the time. People don't know that something really happened for whatever. I mean, the marketing guys get a hold of things and they just make things up. Really, from my perspective, the reason why mountain bikes happened was because the eyes of the world were on the American scene in cycling, because of Le Mans. And we got noticed in the process. And we ended up triggering something because there was a down cycle in the whole world of cycling. They were looking for something new. In the same way, the question is, you know, what's new? What's new? Well, back then there was a touring bike, there was a road bike, there was a BMX bike. Now we have, multiply that by 20 times. They were asking the question, what's new? And the mountain bike comes along completely new, looking, with a whole different kind of wild personality to it. And we could have just easily just bumped along and not been noticed. But because of Le Mans, we were celebrated, in my opinion. Because of Le Mans, the eyes of the world were on what we were doing. And I just want to acknowledge that. I just want to say that you know, this story is something that I will tell because I lived it. And I have nothing to benefit really by telling you this story other than just getting it off my chest, that's the truth.
Anybody from the crowd have a question? You've touched on it a little bit, some of the other questions, but I was wondering, you talked about marketers and salespeople and creating buzz and hype around things, then going out and selling it. Maybe it catches on, maybe it doesn't. What was the biggest thing that kind of came to market that, as it was coming to market, you realized this is going to fall on its face in 1-2 years? And then on the other side, is there anything that came to market and evolved that you didn't think would catch on or have significance that